send thy holy angel from heaven to guard and cherish, protect and visit, and evermore defend all who assemble in this place through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
I will go into the altar of God.
Even to the God of my joy and violence.
Send it with me, O God, and defend my cause against the ungodly people, and deliver me from the deceitful and wicked man.
For thou art the God of my strength. Why hast thou put me from thee? And why do I so heavily while the enemy oppresses me?
O send I thy light and thy truth, that they may lead me, and bring me to thy holy hill, and to thy dwelling.
And I may go to the altar of God, even to God my joy and gladness, and upon my heart will I give thanks unto thee, O God, my God.
Why art thou so heavy, O my soul, and why art thou so disquieted within me?
O Lord, put thy trust in God, for I will give him thanks, which is not for my countenance, and my God.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
I will go unto the altar of God.
Even unto the God of my joy and gladness.
Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who hath made heaven and earth.
I confess, Almighty God, the Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, the Blessed Michael the Archangel, the Blessed John Baptist, the Holy Apostles Peter and Paul, all the saints and thee, my brethren, that I have sinned exceedingly in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, by my own fault, by my own most grievous fault. Wherefore I beg, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, Blessed Michael the Archangel, Blessed John Baptist, the Holy Apostles Peter and Paul, all the angels and saints, and thee, my brethren, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy upon thee, forgive thee thy sins, and bring thee to everlasting life.
Amen.
I confess to Almighty God, to Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, to Blessed Michael the Archangel, to Blessed John Baptist, to the Holy Apostles Peter and Paul, to all the saints, and to thee, Father, that I have sinned exceedingly in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, by my own fault, by my own most grievous fault. Wherefore I beg, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, Blessed Michael, the Archangel, Blessed John, the Baptist, the Holy Apostles, Peter and Paul, all the angels and saints, and thee, Father, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy upon thee, forgive thee thy sins, and bring thee to everlasting life.
Amen.
The Almighty and merciful Lord, grant unto us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins.
Amen.
Wilt thou not turn again and quicken us, O God?
That thy people may rejoice in thee.
Show us thy mercy, O Lord.
And grant us thy salvation.
Lord, hear my prayer.
And let my cry come unto thee.
Without end. Amen.
When
the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ saith. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. Second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Work is a vexation. night his mind does not rest. This also is vanity. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Keep me, O Lord, as the apple of an eye. Hide me under the shadow of thy wings. Let my sentence come forth from thy presence, and let mine eyes look upon the thing that is equal.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Colossians. Brethren, if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are of the earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you: immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have put off the old man with his practices, and have put on a new man, who is being renewed in knowledge after the image of his Creator. Here there cannot be Greek or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, free man, but Christ is all and in all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
put to death what is earthly in you.
May the words of my mouth and meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
The three readings today, one from the Old Testament, one from the New Testament letters, and one from the Gospel. I'll have this idea of not being attentive to the things in this world. Now, those of us who are in this world, our focus of attention for things in this world happen to be material possessions. And what's really unfortunate is there are millions, and I mean that literally, millions of people that are going to leave Catholic parishes today and are going to hear how, you know, it's wrong to accumulate this, and it's, you're not giving enough to the poor and all this kind of stuff. As I always tell people, you know, you're never going to see me get up here, never going to hear once anything about a homily on giving to the poor. I expect that of you. That should not be anything that I have to say. If you're right with Jesus Christ, if your relationship is what it should be with him, you are going to be giving to the poor. That's all there is to it. You will allow no one to be around you in want. It is a consequence of a proper relationship with Jesus Christ. And even those three readings, again, the focus is upon priorities. It's not about material possessions. It's about priorities. It's about refocusing in our Catholic lives. It is about orientation. Everything that we do and everything that we think should be run through the filter of our Lord Jesus Christ. Everything. It is about changing. It is about getting better. That's what's expected. It's about learning. Our Lord says, the reading from Colossians really drives the point home. It's not about material position. It's about putting to death what is earthly in you, as the scripture says. The Holy Spirit speaks through St. Paul. It is the manifestation, the requirement of our application of our baptismal contract. Your baptism is a contract. You make promises. We make promises at our baptism. Now, generally, for most of us, that's when we're infants. But guess what? In your confirmation, that's exactly what it is. You are confirming that what someone else accepted for you as an infant, you are confirming of your own volition that the change is going to occur in your life, that you abide by the contract, so to speak. And what is our baptismal contract? What is it? The Holy Spirit tells us in Romans. He tells us through St. Paul, he said, you are buried with Christ in your baptism. You do not bury people that are alive, all right? You are buried with Christ in baptism, and you are raised in newness of life. We love to hear about this whole new thing. We love to hear that we are new creations. We love to hear of our newness and our adoption in Christ. And we should. We should relish in that. We should glorify. But we can never lose sight of the fact that that newness negates the old. Things have got to change. That's the whole reason. Why be baptized? Why be confirmed if nothing's going to change? Why go to church now on Sundays? Big deal. Big deal. Sleep in on Sundays if nothing's changing in your life. If you don't live out there the way you say you do in here, all the amens that we say in here before our Lord, body, blood, soul, and divinity in the tabernacle, all those amens we say, if you're not going to live that life, I mean this in all sincerity, sleep in on something, because your soul is in much more jeopardy if you come here and lie or double-tongue things than it would be if you would just sleep in on Sundays. Our Lord expects change. That is, as I said, our baptismal contract. When we embrace this contract, we are supposed to put to death what is earthly in us. A couple verses later, you have died and your life is hid with Christ. You know, sitting in the office this morning talking about Calvinism and how, you know, the grace alone, faith alone, all this alone stuff. We have in this very passage, it talks about his grace. It talks about how we've died in him. And now he expects something of you. He expects a practical application of things. A lot of time I get up here and go, this is not a moralistic sermon. This is a moralistic sermon. These are moralisms. They're not suggestions. It's what our Lord demands of us. The practical application of our faith. This whole idea of a new man. When a new man comes, the old things have to end. Our Lord Jesus talks about you cannot put, you know, old wine in new wineskins. They will burst. It can't coexist. We have to become new. We have to mortify, so to speak, our irregular desire. Not so to speak, mortify, literally. Mortify, mortification. I pray God you know what that term is. I think there are a whole lot of Catholics in our day and age that don't. We are supposed to mortify, to kill these old things that are within us. They are supposed to end. And it does lean that literal. That's where we get the word from, the same root, mortician. We mortify, we put to death our irregular desires, those things that were of the old man. Because when we do that, we are enabled to subdue the temptations with which we are inundated in our day and age. You know, temptations have always been around, always, okay? But I mean, back in the day, you could, you know, walk, you know, before things got industrialized and urbanized, you know, you could walk down a path and you wouldn't have to worry about looking at a billboard that had a suggestive picture on it. Punch up your computer and be researching something about, you know, some scientific research and have a pop-up ad come up because of something that you looked at 2 weeks ago that's suggestive also. We almost seemingly can't get away from it. In our day, it is of the utmost importance to mortify these irregular desires within us. And that is up to us. Remember, our Lord Jesus Christ says, without me, you can do nothing. But because of the sacraments, because of his word, because of prayer, you can overcome these things, and he expects you to do so. He expects you to uphold your part of the bargain in your baptism by mortifying these irregular desires, by having an elevated viewpoint, not viewpoint, worldview. It's more than viewpoint, it's worldview. We as Catholics have an elevated worldview. Not just, a lot of people hear world, oh yeah, what you should view the world differently than the world does. But how does generally the folk out there think about the world? Cutthroat, get what you can, you know, if it feels good, do it, all this other kind of good stuff like that, you know, get what I can, it's all about me. We have an elevated worldview. You know, we ought not sit here and go, oh, I'm this, they're that. They have that worldview and I have this one, so never the twain shall meet. No, we're supposed to let them know what they can have in Christ Jesus. We're supposed to let them know the grace that he shows us. And then we're supposed to emphasize with them that they are supposed to change. That is where I would submit to you that, unfortunately, the church in the general gist of things is falling short. Not telling people that they have to change. Not saying that the old man has to be put to death. Oh, you love Jesus, you go to church, that's good. Give to the poor, that, and, you know, everything will be well. No, everything will not be well. I point out quite frequently, there are philanthropists in this world who give, I mean literally, billions of dollars to charity. They give more to charity than probably all of us in here combined will ever know as far as money. And if they don't repent, they'll go straight to hell when they die because they do it for the wrong motive. They haven't changed. They have not become new. They just throw money at things and hope it goes away. And that's not what our Lord wants. Our Lord wants us to go out there. He didn't say one thing about going out there and throwing money at anything. He says, go out there and make disciples. That's what he says. And to make disciples, to become a disciple, you have to convert. And that means turning away from something. We have to have an elevated viewpoint, an elevated worldview. And you know where it's got to start? It's not going to do anything if it doesn't start right here for each and every one of us as individuals. This elevated view has to, even for ourselves. This is not to puff you up, but as a result of your baptism and as a result of your confirmation, you should have an elevated view of yourself. I despise when people come up to me as a, you know, I hear them talk to someone, well, I, you know, I'm no better than that person out in the street. I'm no better. That's a ridiculous statement. That's blasphemous to say that you're the same as a person that's unbaptized and unconfirmed. You are in union with Christ Jesus. And when you're in union with Christ Jesus, you are markedly different from them. At the very end of this passage, it says, here there cannot be Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, and it goes on. What is he talking about when he says, here there cannot be? Here in Christ. Because everybody's in Christ is the same. But if you're not in Christ, you're not. You heard it here first, folks. There's a lot of drivel coming on right now. Oh, our brother and sister this, our brother and sister that. That's not the case. They're only your brother and sister if they are in Christ. That's it. We love them. They bear the image of God. But unless they're in Christ, they're not your brother and sister. Sorry. But that's the case. Our Lord says it here. Herein there cannot be Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, Scythian or barbarian. In Christ, that doesn't apply. Outside of Christ, it does. That which makes it so glorious to come to Christ is because then we are all one. This idea of change is not a suggestion. It is a demand of our Lord. It's not suggestion. This is one of those times. They've been frequent here lately. I told last night, I think I'm going to get a buzzer, like on the game shows, when you hit it and the lights flash and there's a big alarm. When you hear a reading and it's edited and there's something left out, I should hit the buzzer while it's being read, because you should be on guard. You'll notice in your bulletin, the lectionary reading today says Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 5 and 9 through 11. As soon as you see that gap, you go, I wonder what's going on in verses 7 through 10. Or, you know, what's going on there? As I always say, you know what's going on there? You can almost guarantee this. Something about judgment, something about hell, something about the necessity of you converting. Something that's required of you. And guess what? That's the case today. Because if you read the reading the way it is this morning, it sounds like a suggestion. It sounds like, you know, you can give this or take this. If you want to be a uber Catholic, then you do these things. If you want to be real holy and real pious, then you do these things. If it's read the way we heard it this morning, when you leave three verses out, particularly verse 7. This is what it says, okay? If this is the word of God, just like the other parts. If somebody just sat in an office somewhere and decided, this is too harsh for them. This shows the necessity of the change. After the list comes, and it's only one list, we'll get to that in a second. You know, all this talk about, you know, immorality, impurity, passion, evil desires, covetousness. Again, we shouldn't do that stuff. Appreciate the suggestion. The next verse is, on account of these, the wrath of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience. That changes the story completely. It changed from, here's this list, give it or take it, to, on account of these, the wrath of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience. I don't like to hear about that wrath of God stuff. That's Old Testament. Well, duh, that comes from the New Testament. Holy Spirit says the wrath of God abides on the sons of disobedience. And then he gives another list. Because that list that I just read, that's them out there. We're not immoral. We're not impure. We don't give over to our passions and evil desires. We're not covetous. come to my office, we'll sit down. I will tell you how the vast majority of us, and I will use myself as an example, do violations of those things every single day. So it's not them out there. But then there's another list, okay? Those are the high-end things that we just read. And then you get this other list that you didn't hear this morning. Anger, wrath, malice, slander, foul talk, using bad language. Those common everyday things. Every single day. The common things. Those no less separate us from our Lord Jesus Christ than those big things. He expects you to change. He expects you to be different. What family in this world, what family, well-ordered family anyway, would a father direct his children, don't do that. I'll do it if I want to. Okay. We would make fun of that guy. What a slack jaw he is. That's not a father that would let his kids do whatever they want, or mother to let anybody do what they want. A well-ordered family, it doesn't happen like that. And why do fathers and mothers nurture their children? Why do they direct them? Why do they punish them? To make them better. So you don't come away from this thinking, oh, that's one of those heavy homilies, that, you know, this do this and don't do that stuff. You know, I want that loving God. That's why it's there. That's how much he loves you. He wants you to get better. And unless you get a grip on these things, you won't get better. You will not get better. And that's what he expects. He loves us. So these are the things that actually express his love, not the warm and fuzzies talking about knew this and knew that and sitting in here and listening to stuff that makes you feel good. It's about changing your life. This is where you hear about it. Out there is where you do it. This is about changing. He wants us to change because he loves us. And there is consequences if you don't change. What happens to a little kid when dad tells, don't do that? No. Well, in my house when I was growing up, shame on you. All right? Get this. Go sit over there. I couldn't sit. Something like going that, you know? Ah, the good old days. He loves us. He wants us to change. St. Jose Maria Escriva, he talks about two practical applications of this particular reading. He says, one, it indicates to us that we need to do everything with a supernatural purpose. Everything that you do in life. It's not about Sunday morning, Sunday afternoon, Saturday evening, whenever you go. It's not about that time. It's about your life. And it's about every day doing everything. Everything with a supernatural purpose. If you're thinking about buying a car or buying a house, you know, I say that quite frequently. Do it through the lens of Christ. Pray about it. Ask our Lord, do I need this? Do I need this? Do I need to put a burden on my budget for this? Am I in a position to do this? Is it necessary? It may very well be. Ask him first. Everything that we do should have a supernatural purpose. And that kind of leads into the second point he makes. When we do these things, you know, we hear this, like I said before, if you read these things, all that, well, that's just the hyper-Catholic thing, you know, I'm just going to live my life. We can't. We can't just live the old life. But you have to understand that it doesn't take some great undertaking. You know, you don't have to slap a habit on your head and go sit around your house and never come out until you're going to church. That's not what it's talking about at all. It's talking about just the opposite. It's talking about engaging in the world. It's talking about honoring Christ in absolutely everything you do, whether you dig ditches or work on brains, or whether you're a homeschool mom, everything that you do should be done to honor Christ and to communicate his truth to those who are around you, who are watching you do these things that honor Christ. So you see the integrity between the two things. It's about growth. Don't get disheartened and don't get disappointed with, I don't see this kind of change in my life, and I've been in the church for 10 years. You know, I'm just going to stay away because I can't do this. As I always point out, that word can't, ridiculous. It's not I can't do this or I can't stop doing that. It's I won't. It's I won't stop doing this or I won't start doing that. Our Lord demands that we do. It's not up to you to say whether you can't or won't. If you're in Christ, he expects this of you. But our growth is from stage to stage, and it can be excruciatingly slow. It's like planting a tree. You plant a sapling. It looks like a stick. And you go out a month later. It still looks like a stick. You go out a year later. Still pretty much looks like a stick. Go away for 10 or 20 years and come back and see what it looks like. That's our growth. I used the illustration this morning to tie this all up. He wants a... St. Paul talks about the struggle between the old man and the new man. Our Lord is telling us here that we need to put the old man to death. To use colloquialisms, we don't just shoot him, or we just don't cut his head off. It doesn't work like that. We need to beat him to death. We need to beat the old man to death. And it's really hard to beat someone to death. It's particularly hard if you don't have any enthusiasm to do it. How long is it going to take to beat somebody to death if you tap them on the cheek every now and then for a couple months go away and then come back and tap them on the cheek a couple times? How long is it going to take to beat him to death? You need to beat him to death. And you know what? You get in a fight, just from my back in the old days, back in the police days, you get in a fight, even if you win, you are real sore the next day. Even when you win, you're sore. It hurts to fight. It hurts bad. That's what our Lord expects from us. If you can look at that, you say, well, I don't have to fight hard. Here's your example right there. Okay? He did that for you. You can't fight. If you don't fight, you're going to surrender. And you don't want to surrender to our enemy. This is about orientation. It's about change. And with this, quote from that. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on the earth. This is not an option. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's church and the world. Almighty and ever-living God, who in thy holy word has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, receive these our prayers which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord. I grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word, live in unity and godly love. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, Francis our Pope, Stephen, our bishop, His Holiness Benedict XVI, John, the Bishop of Orlando, and to all bishops and other sacred ministers, especially Deacon Andrew, that they may, both by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And who about thy people give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. We beseech thee also so to rule the hearts of those who bear the authority of government in this and every land, that they may be led to wise decisions and right actions for the welfare and peace of the world. Open, O Lord, the eyes of all people to behold thy gracious hand in all thy works, the rejoicing in thy whole creation, they may honor thee with their substance and be faithful stewards of thy bounty. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear. Beseeching thee to be merciful and grant the fullness of joy in thy love and service, and to grant us grace so to follow the good examples of the Blessed Virgin Mary, of Saint Ignatius Loyola, and of all thy saints, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant these our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our mediator and advocate, who with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory.
Amen.
Ye that do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God and walking henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith, make your humble confession to Almighty God, meekly kneeling upon your knees. Almighty God,
Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed by thought, word, and deed against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and our heart is sorry for these our misdoings, the remembrance of them is grievous unto us, the burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us, have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, with the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
May Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who, with heart and repentance, have true faith, turn unto him, have mercy on us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and bring us to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what comfortable words our Savior Christ said to all who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hear also what St. Paul saith. This is a true saying and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear also what St. John saith. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is a propitiation for our sins.
To thee, O Lord, lift I up my soul. O my God, in thee have I trusted. Let me not be confounded. Now I bear that my enemies triumph over me, for all they that hope in thee shall not be ashamed.
Pray, brethren, that this, my sacrifice and yours, may be acceptable unto God the Father Almighty.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at thy hands, for the praise of the Lord in his name, for our good and good of all of his church.
O Lord, who hast instituted this sacrifice to be a remembrance of the effectual continuance of the work of our redemption, grant, we pray thee, that we may ever be enabled by thee to draw near in worthiness unto these holy mysteries, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is meet and right so to do.
It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty, everlasting God, creator of the light and source of life, who hast made us in thine image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, safe, O God, we beseech thee in all things to make this oblation blessed, approved, and accepted, a perfect and worthy offering, that it may become for us the body and blood of thy dearly beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who the day before he suffered, took bread into his holy and venerable hands. And with eyes lifted up to heaven unto thee, God, his almighty Father, giving thanks to thee, he blessed, broke, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. Likewise, after supper, taking also this goodly chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again giving thanks to thee, he blessed and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
O Savior of the world, who by thy cross and precious blood has redeemed us, save us and help us, we humbly beseech thee, O Lord.
Wherefore, O Lord, we thy servants and thy holy people also, remembering the blessed passion of the same Christ, thy Son, our Lord, as also his resurrection from the dead and his glorious ascension into heaven, do offer unto thine excellent majesty of thine own gifts and bounty, the pure victim, the holy victim, the immaculate victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Vouchsafe to look upon them with a merciful, pleasant countenance, to accept them, even as thou didst vouchsafe to accept the gifts of thy servant Abel the righteous, and the sacrifice of our patriarch Abraham, and the holy sacrifice, the immaculate victim, which thy high priest Melchizedek offered unto thee. We humbly beseech thee, Almighty God, command these offerings to be brought by the hands of thy holy angel to thine altar on high, in sight of thy divine majesty, that all we who at this partaking of the altar shall receive the most sacred body and blood of thy Son, may be fulfilled with all heavenly benediction and grace. Remember also, O Lord, thy servants and handmaids who have gone before us, seal with the seal of faith, sleep the sleep of peace. To them, O Lord, and to all that rest in Christ, we beseech that you grant the abode of refreshing, of light, and of peace. To us sinners also, thy servants, who hope in the multitude of thy mercies, vouchsafe to grant a pardon and fellowship with thy holy apostles and martyrs, with John, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicitas, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and with all thy saints, within whose fellowship we beseech thee, admit us not weighing our merit, but granting us forgiveness, through Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom, O Lord, thou dost ever create all these good things, thou sanctify, quicken, bless, and bestow them upon. By whom, and with whom, and in whom? To the old Father Almighty, the unity of the Holy Ghost, the all honor and glory throughout all ages, world without end.
Amen. our Savior Christ hath commanded it on us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in
in our days, and by the help of thine availing mercy, we may ever both be free from sin and safe from all distress.
For thine is the kingdom and the power of glory, forever and ever. Amen.
O Lord Jesus Christ, who said to thine apostles, Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Regard not our sin, but the faith of thy church, and grant to her peace and unity according to thy will, who livest and reignest with the Father and the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with thy spirit.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him that taketh away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed.
Shall be pleased with the sacrifice of righteousness.
sins, our Lord, we thank thee for the knowledge he gives us in these holy mysteries, with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And thus assure us that God, by favor, remains towards us, and that we are very members of the glory of the blissful body of thy Son, the blessed company of all faithful people, that are also heirs of hope of thy everlasting kingdom, by the merits of the most precious death and passion of thy dear Son. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us in thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all such good works that thou hast prepared for us to walk in. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, the world without end. Amen.
Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, we pray thee, that this holy communion, which we have received, may cleanse us from all our sins, and bestow upon us unity and concord through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Depart in peace.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Be the Holy Gospel according to St. John the Divine.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same as in the beginning with God, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. The same came for witness, to bear witness to the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came into his own, and his own received him not, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory is the only begotten Father, full of grace and truth.
Thanks be to God.